Hi folks. Well, when it came to a video like this, I had to sit down and have a bit of a think. I had to consider, how do I start a video like this? To be honest, the conclusion wasn't that long in coming. I determined that the first thing I should do on this kind of video is disable the comments section. Because let's face it, discussion on these sorts of topics can get a bit heated. Yes. So, anyway, bit of history. As you guys know about me, I'm a career techie. A small portion of my life has been spent as a professional photographer, and a good chunk of it as an enthusiastic amateur. On top of that, in the mid-90s, I wrote a couple of very specialist books, and recently I've returned to the book writing fray, with two out, one with a publisher, and the latest one is only a couple of thousand words from being finished. To that end, I had to work out my workflow because, you know, I got a 9-to-5 job with a hellish commute. Well, not such hellish, just time consuming, an hour each way, and I have to drive. I'm not on the train. So I've been trying all sorts of tips, tricks and mechanisms to aid my workflow. One of the things that came out of that is, for my main workstation, I cannot write creatively. I can do a lot of the technical stuff, proofreading, corrections, other stuff like that, but I cannot write creatively. For that, enter the HP Stream. Now, this proved to me that I could take it somewhere else, bedroom, living room, somewhere that I was comfortable. Then I could get on with writing the parts that required concentration, you know, relaxation, you know, somewhere I could write a decent dialogue between characters, and I could forge action scenes with a bit more care that were easier to read. That sort of thing. So, I think pretty much that the stream was made to a price, and the cynic in me would say that this was, it wouldn't surprise me to find out that this was bankrolled a little bit by Microsoft in order to encourage people onto their cloud services. To that degree, it has obviously been made for a price. One of the reasons why I went for this over a Chromebook is because I could put Linux on it, because it came with Windows 8.1 and that seems to be going the way of Vista. Not quite as badly as Vista went, but certainly along the same sort of lines. So I knew it was made for a price, but there were a few things that I didn't know. Yeah. One was the quality of the chipsets in here, and in particular the Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi in here does not play nicely with Linux. So I had to get an external Wi-Fi dongle, unit, whatever, USB. That took up one of the USB slots and made it, you know, gave something extra, a bit on the edge that you got to watch for, you know. and the other thing was that the trackpad was absolutely crap. It just doesn't work right. Doesn't click very well at all. I did try and load some software on here, and I could get the software to auto-load, but I couldn't get the software to automatically switch off the trackpad as a matter of course. So I had to take the thing apart and dismantle it and disconnect the thing. Just as a mode of attempting it, a few days ago I reconnected it and gave it another shot, and it only lasted a few minutes before I disconnected it again. That's had the downside that I need to cart a mouse around with me. As you'll notice, this particular mouse is dead. That's because one of the USB sockets has died. And as you'll see, if I take it out of there and plug it in there, instant light. It works. In there, no. So that's dead. On top of that, the quality of the machine itself, for £230, it's not too bad. It's got this Beats brand for the audio on it. I'm just going to shut this down. And it's not as bad as some. It's not as bad as it could be, but it could certainly be a darn sight better. The keyboard is quite nice. I like the keyboard. And I also like the screen. It's a nice, crisp display. Again, not as crisp as some, but perfectly adequate for what I need. And I'm certainly not seeing any issues with it, to be perfectly honest. However, 6 months down the line, the battery is also not as it should be. I noticed even from the word go that it wasn't really keeping a charge. You could charge it up, give it a week or two, and that was it. Good night, Vienna. You'd have to charge it up again. So it was built for a price. I needed a replacement. The problem was, what to replace it with? Chromebooks? No, thank you very much. That really only left one other unit, which was pretty much the same as the Stream in terms of size, thinness, fanless. And yes, I know. Please, sit down. Don't die of shock on me here. You ready? Yes. I actually wound up buying a MacBook Air with my own money, of course. Now, this is pretty much the lowest entry-level Air that I could get. 4 gig of RAM, 128 gig of flash storage, brand new, £850. This is refurbished, £630. Thank you very much. That's more kind the kind of price that I'm talking about. Right. In terms of overall value, do I think it's worth £850? No. Do I think it's worth £630? Well, it might have been, if for one critical issue that has been sorted for the short term, but in the long term, who knows? It's a little touch lighter than the Stream. It is still just over 15 inches corner to corner, and the screen is 13.3-ish inches corner to corner. It's not bad. Feels good quality. There's been talk about some of it being aluminium and some of it being plastic. I don't really know. It feels reasonably solid. Sound was one of the first things that hit me when I took it for a test drive. I cannot see any speaker grills here, but the sound on this is pretty much the best that I've heard from any unit of this type that I've ever had my hands on. Can't say more than that, really. The only thing that annoys me about the sound is that when you turn the machine on, it gives the usual bong when it starts. I really wish that there was an easy way to turn that off and that it only gave you a bong if there was something wrong. A wrong bong. Yeah. because, you know, when an idea hits in the middle of the night, you know, I just pick it up, turn it on, start using it, and the bong can wake people up. There you go. There's been plenty of discussion, to put a very polite point on it, in various forums. There have been various tips and tricks. They don't really work on Yosemite 10.10.3, I think this is. But that's about it for the sound. Screen, nice, crisp. Can't say much more, really. This is not a Retina display, and for my eyesight and for my needs, I wouldn't need one, because this is beautiful. Yeah, the keyboard is pretty nice quality to type on as well. I'd put it on a par with the screen. Stream. Thank you. Roughly on a par with the Stream. It's got the added benefit that it is backlit. You're not going to see this here, I don't think, because there is an automatic dimming. You kind of turned it away from the window, so the dimming has... Yeah, there's an auto dim on it. And one of the common errors is if you try and adjust the backlight and it gives you a no entry sign. And it's typically because the ambient light is too bright, as I found out. Finding odds and sods like that out as I go. The big problem with the keyboard for me is that despite this being a UK Mac, as people have said, is if you have a look at the number 2, you've got the at symbol instead of the double quotes, which is down there, 2 to the right of the L. That's a real problem for me. Reason being is because I'm a touch typist. When we did our OND more than 20 odd years ago, coming up to 30 years ago, not far off it, a few years off that, I think, they did a number of things for us. Although it was a computer studies course, we had to take and pass an exam in keyboarding skills. So I'm a 70 word per minute typist when I get going, really. We were taught to touch type, had to pass exams. So I touch without, I type without even looking at the keyboard most times when I'm in the flow. And the last thing, you know, I sat down with this, started working away. We work on these things at work. You know, they come in, we do bits on them, they go out. And I've never really noticed the at quote, double quote thing until I started working on a book last night. And then my characters were speaking in ats. Not very good. So that fact alone is pretty much going to make sure that I never buy another MacBook again. More on that in a bit. But yeah, the exam was fun. There was one poor soul in the typing exam. We were taught and took our exams on these electric typewriters, and they had these autocorrect ribbons. Whereas you know, they got what, they're loaded with whiteout, so they step. You press the button, they step back as it whites out the character and then goes on to the next. So it takes a few moments for that to happen. And there was one poor bloke in the exam. He needed to delete a few characters, obviously, and he kept his finger on the button. So he was sat there with his finger on the button. And when he got to that point, he took his finger off the button. But it had a buffer. So even though he took the finger off his button, it was going and just the look of horror on his face as the typewriter just happily sat there wiping out his entire exam submission. None of us could say anything. I think pretty much all of us wanted to say, switch it off, pull the power. He failed. He was the only one of us that failed. But that's pretty much how we were taught. It's a skill that's given me some embarrassment at times, because I remember one particular time I was in Frankfurt in an office there typing away, and one of the heads, the head of finance at the time, came into the door. So I was looking at him while I was finishing my finishing the sentence, typing away and looking at him, expecting him to speak. He didn't. He just stood there, waited until I'd finished what I was typing, and then walked off. Okay. But the OND course did a lot for us. We also learned other things like double entry bookkeeping, and we learned how businesses work so that we could apply our skills to the business, because the business is the customer. You have to understand the customer and adapt what you do for the customer's needs. And that's a trick that I think that Apple could do with learning in some aspects. Because as far as writing is concerned, if I was only using Mac, I could possibly get used to this, but I'm jumping between machines. No chance. I mean, IT is my job. So, my bacon was saved, sort of. More on that in a very short time. Log on to this machine is pretty quick. Power on to log on. Smart. I think they've achieved it by shifting some process starts later on to after the logon, for example, mounting external media, other things like that. So that's how I think they've achieved the speed on this. or part of the reason. They've got some decent components in here, obviously. Right, keyboarding. They've got some very nice stuff in here. Just going to try and watch the mic. If I just bring down that, have I done it? There we go. One of these programs you'll see is the black one, and it's called, what's it called? Carabiner. I'd like to say a massive thanks to Specsbean Farmer to sorting this out for me. Now what it does is it allows you to swap keys. I mean, originally when you look at it, it looks, oh my god, but you just scroll down to the usual point, and in fact this is, I've just had this recently open, so you can see it's got four English and international keyboards, and there's a section there specifically to swap the double quotes and the at, and then you just press the reload XML, and then it's, the keyboard works for you. So at last I can touch type again. It has saved this from going back to Apple and or being thrown out the window. My worry is that there has been software like this before. Indeed, we tried a different piece of software, but it doesn't work on Yosemite, it doesn't work on 1010. So the obvious fear in my mind is, as the software gets upgraded, is that Carabiner going to suddenly fail, stop working, or not be, you know, not work anymore. Hello? No, I don't want that. Thank you. So yeah, the keyboard is a big concern, and it's enough of a red light to me that that's it. This is going to be my first and last MacBook or Mac anything. Yeah. I'll stay on the hardware for a little bit. This is pretty much the only machine that I can ever recall. When you put the storage in it, it stays on the outside. It's enough of a catch to dissuade you from keeping the external storage attached. Everything else, it sort of nicely goes inside the case and stays there. If, you know, the cynic inside me says, that's a way for them to persuade you to buy higher spec MacBooks with more storage in them. That's what the cynic in me would say. But it is what it is. Power consumption. I still haven't come up to a firm thing yet. Because I haven't really attacked it for an entire day. It promised 12 hours on the website. After initial charge, initial use, it said 8 hours, then it updated Yosemite, and then the figure has not been quite so easy to grasp, so time will tell on that one. But I think it's going to last a reasonable length of time. Most of my colleagues and friends that have got these say, yeah, you should expect a good few years of use out of it. Right, there are inconsistencies on here that are driving me nuts. Things like the command control, you know, outside the standard keyboard on these laptops, Chromebooks, everything's just different these days. So the outer lying keys, you can expect, I was expecting that to be different. I was also expecting a different workflow because, you know, we've worked with iPads and even, I've got a works iPhone, had that for a few years. Using that was pretty much one of the persuasions against me bothering with Apple. And if it hadn't been for the fact that this was the only thing around that fitted the bill, I'd have gone for something else. But okay, let's say for example I've just loaded what's it called, Finder. Okay, so you're in the file structure, you want to create a new folder, so you sort of right-click-ish, and you get Create Folder. Okay, fair enough. Whoops, what did I end up? Right. If you're in another Apple thing, like Photos, for example, and you want to make a new album, for example, you right-click. No, it doesn't do anything. So you have to use Command-N, and that gets you, that triggers off a new folder. A new album, rather. So you get used to that, and then you're back in Finder, and let's just close that. You're back in Finder, and you command N, and what happens? It starts a new Finder. So, you know, there's a bit of a lack of consistency over here. And also, there's a lack of consistency in closing the programs. I'm just going to start a couple up here. I've just started Firefox, and you can see the usual three icons: close, minimize, and maximize. Close doesn't always close. If I hit the red X, what's happened is it's actually still running. There's a little dot underneath the Firefox thing there that tells me the process is still running. So actually what I've got to do is Command Q to quit. Okay, I can manage that. However, in Photos, if I do it on that one and hit the red X, you'll notice no dot. It's closed it. The red axis has successfully closed it. Also in Photos, if I open that up again and attempt to command Q it, you'll see that it also closes it. However, if we're in Finder, Control Q does nothing. You've got to use the red X. I don't think you can ever actually close Finder. There's always one process running somewhere, I think. There are other oddities going on here as well. I haven't got to the bottom yet as to why FileZilla does not want to connect to a server via SFTP. The damn thing is actually local, and it doesn't want to know. FTP? Fine. SFTP? No chance. Don't know why. So there are all sorts of oddities to try and get to grips with. And I was expecting oddities. You know, like with the iPhone, trying to Bluetooth. All I wanted to do was Bluetooth a video file to a laptop, because I couldn't actually connect it. No dice. So I'm expecting oddities, but we've got to see what happens. There's a lot of nice touches on here. For example, the swipes, you know, swipe between desktops. There's a degree of cool action here going on. One of the things that I haven't found yet is how to get, you know, I've got the backgrounds to change every half an hour, but they're all independent. Can't link them to all have the same background and all change the same background. Little niggle there. there's also some very nice stuff, very innovative stuff that goes so far but doesn't go further. For example, Photos. It's got a very nice slideshow feature, so I can go into something. I won't play it because it'll wind up playing music. You just select the images, say, okay, give me a slideshow, and it does it. At the moment, I haven't found a way to control the speed. It's just too fast. Also, I think Classic is the only one that actually shows them as they are, one by one. All the others seem to merge them into various concoctions, and indeed starts cropping and messing around with the images in order to make them the images fit its various concoctions. You know, like one big one and two small ones and stuff like that. And it's, I can't see any settings anywhere to turn that off. And it also only does what's here. So if I stuck in a USB key with Photos, I can't run it off the USB key. I've got to load them into the local storage in order to do a slideshow. So there's things like that missing. I've got the feeling that there was other stuff that I wanted to say about this, but some of my colleagues and friends and Specsbean have basically saved my patience on some of this. Otherwise this would have been a complete waste of time. Shown me a few tips, tricks to get me running. There's still an awful lot to learn. I mean, I knew when I approached this that it was going to be a new workflow. I just wasn't quite expecting this, especially from something which is billed as being well thought through. You know, that there's all sorts of inconsistencies and stuff missing, which is why if it was smoother, worked better, and actually those innovative things went the full way, then maybe I'd be more inclined to pay something like $850. But, nah. The keyboard is a real deal breaker for me. That basically, if I could have confidence that the software was always going to be there to swap those things around, the at and the double quote, maybe, if it was part of the operating system. But if it's part of a third-party piece of software, which may not work with, indeed, given Apple's, well, anything might happen. I mean, Apple have thrown things out from being usable for all sorts of reasons, simple competition or anything. And also, developers of some pieces of software move on to other projects and leave the other stuff running, especially the free stuff. And it's very often seems to be the free stuff that makes the difference. I think this one's probably going to run its course, learn more about it, because there is an awful lot to learn on this, and there are some very nice touches, particularly the scroll and the touchpad gestures, pretty good. It's just a shame it's the odd things, really. If I was using one of these day in, day out, nothing else, potentially I might get used to it. But, nah. Not while I'm jumping between machines and doing different things. Yes, I'm stalling because I'm pretty sure that there's other things in there that I wanted to show you. But, I'll leave this and close it up by saying, Lenovo, Toshiba, if you guys are listening and you can come up with a machine hardware that quality and give the customer the choice of operating system, you know, decent chipsets that work well, respond well, and work with pretty much most operating systems with ease, I think you could really make a dent in the market with a machine like that. To HP, there is only one thing I can say, really, and that is that I think that there is only one reason why the stream has rounded edges. It's because you've cut too many bloody corners. See you on the next video, folks.